Sometimes popular history has blind spots. One classic revolver, primary to the U.S. Armed Forces for the Spanish-American War, has fallen into near obscurity. However, that did not stop it from being dusted off for the Great War. Hi, I'm Othais, and this is the Colt New Army, a somewhat dated, by the time of the Great War, U.S. service revolver. Let's take a look at the light box. Weighing in at just over 2 pounds, and with an overall length of 11.5 inch, this is a full-size service revolver. It chambers the 38 long Colt cartridge, 6 of them in its swing-out cylinder. Now, usually on this show, we like to get into the itty-bitty, teeny-weeny, nitty-gritty details. But when you're talking about the history of Colt, one that's, almost 2 centuries in the making, with a very charismatic and unusual man at the helm for much of that, and then a number of other odd gentlemen and geniuses along the way, and then some... we won't talk about more modern Colt. There is just too much to cover. So we are going to go through a quick general rundown because this is the first time we've really brought him into the show. Born July 19th, 1814, to a farmer-turned-textiles businessman, Samuel Colt would grow up with a fascination for invention and pyrotechnics. Thanks to a July 4th experiment gone raging inferno, he would be booted out of boarding school in 1830, and straight out into seafaring work. Observing the clutch mechanism on a ship's wheel, he would be inspired to improve the Elijah Collier revolving flintlock action. His main contribution to that action would be to have that manually operated hammer automatically revolve the cylinder and lock into position, which, when combined with the new cap lock technology, resulted in the now famous Colt Patterson. Now, I would love to talk about Samuel Colt for the rest of this episode because he was as or much more fascinating than Charles Ross, and there are a lot of escapades in his history. I recommend any biography on this man. But it would be a little odd because he wasn't even alive to see the invention of our version today. Instead, it was the Colt factory that was behind this gun. And that really, the way we understand it in the modern sense, or at least in the sense of these guns, was founded in 1855 as the Colt Armory with a big building and matching personal mansion. Again, more history we don't really need to go all the way into. However, I will say one thing that we should know right off the bat about Colt, when we're talking about it anytime we talk about it, is that Colt was really the father of American assembly line manufacture. Everyone likes to quote Ford, but believe me, Colt was way ahead of the game because we have letters from him going back into the 1830s where he meant to have interchangeable parts where one man would do a couple things and the next man would do a couple things. This guy was revolutionary, and so was his factory. And so that's where we start to see this real innovation out of the Colt factory, not just in terms of firearms, but in terms of manufacture. Again, this is well before this gun here. So let's fast forward. Samuel Colt would live long enough to see the company take a pretty penny out of the war for Southern independence, but he wouldn't survive the whole thing, passing from complications due to gout in 1862. His wife, Elizabeth, would inherit, with Elijah K. Root as the factory president, remaining at the helm until his death in 1865, at which point Elizabeth's brother Richard Jarvis would take the presidency until she sold the company in 1901. Now, I should say that Colt did also live long enough, Samuel Colt, in order to fire one Roland White, which proved to be probably his worst decision because, as we know from our Smith & Wesson episode, that man had a beautiful patent. Now, he didn't have it for the right reasons, but it didn't matter because that put Smith & Wesson into an advantage for well over a decade. But weathering that period of problems, Colt the factory would come back with a vengeance in 1873. This single-action army American legend would serve from, well then, all the way until 1902, although that end date has a bit to do with the limitations of our handgun today. The popularity of the Colt single-action army actually did a lot to slow the progress of handguns in the U.S. Meanwhile, however, Europe was already exploring more compact double-action revolvers. To put it into perspective, this is the French Chamlot Delvin of 1873, the same year. This is a single and double action revolver, and we'll be giving it its own episode soon enough. The concept of a double action had not been lost on Colt. Going back to at least 1842, before his armory was even built, he had experimented with a variant of the Patterson with an eye towards naval adoption. This featured not only a double action trigger, but also a cutlass. Look, we know from our experience with the Smith & Wesson that the double action concept was a winner commercially. And we also know that through the tests of time, it was a winner militarily. But it doesn't mean that it made sense for the US at that time. Remember, and I've covered this before, we had a frontier style army. The number of parts really counted when you had to ship everything all the way across the country with, you know, trails at the best of time. I mean, this is before full rail link, and it's messy. You have to fight in these odd remote territories, and you need to be very conservative with ammo and supply and parts, and it's got to be rugged above all else, and every additional part is an additional complication. So I shouldn't say that it was unfair that the US stuck with the 1873 for so long, and I shouldn't say that it wasn't the perfect gun for the job. That's not where I'm going at all. I'm just saying that it worked so well that it really kept us from kind of pushing the envelope once we had the room to do that, because as we know, by the end of this sort of Indian Wars period, the US troops are being outmatched by the native peoples because they're buying from, you know, the catalog stores, and they're getting rapid fire, excellent firearms, and the US Army is still puttering with single shots. Well, most of the US Army, some of the scouts actually seem to have figured it out. Now, you might think that this sort of mismatch in the frontier would cause the US Army to be one of the biggest pushers, movers of new firearms technology so that they could get ahead of the game. You might think that if you didn't know anything about US procurement, because good lord, they dragged behind the curve for a very long time before the turn of the century. As a matter of fact, by 1903, we're still just playing catch-up, guys. I'm sorry. American pride on terms of innovation doesn't really catch up in the army sense until 1918 and beyond. Now, what did really drive Colt to design a new revolver? If it wasn't U.S. contracts, well, then it has to be from the commercial side, specifically and oddly from Europe. Way back in 1853, Colt had opened a London factory, but it floundered and failed in 1858. It would be replaced by a simple agency reselling US-made guns in 1858. There would also be an agency in Liège, Belgium, headed by one Baron Frederick von Oppen, who would later also absorb responsibility for the London agency. Oppen's job in Europe was to sell Colt revolvers, and for that he had to understand the European market. And for that, he knew that they liked smaller frame double actions at this point. This is where the new technology is. The single action really isn't selling anymore. And so he would push back on Colt and say, no, here's what we need. And in those correspondence, he would usually talk to then Colt Vice President, Major General William Buell Franklin. He would receive samples of competitors' guns and general market information and sort of hand it back around in the factory. Once any drawings or prototypes were ready, he would also then ship them back to Oppen to get his opinion. This process would eventually result in the Model 1877 Lightning. This solid frame double action revolver was sold through 1909, with reasonable success at home. It would also evolve into a military minded, heavier caliber Model 1878 Thunderer. Again, limited commercial success, but neither would see military adoption, and again, neither were particularly impressive to the Europeans. These guns are also known for being fantastically complicated. Once we clear the Great War, I'd really like to sit down with them and look closer. So, double action revolvers patterned after major weather events, or minor ones, anyway. Weather-based revolvers were not cutting it in Europe. So, what would? Well, they already had reliable double-action designs, simpler ones too, and the patents, I'm sure, were all locked up. So what would impress the Europeans? It's going to be based on loading, fast unloading. What we really need is a swing-out cylinder. And Alpin knew this. And by the way, these sorts of simultaneous eject designs had been around in Europe. They just hadn't been popularized and really put out there just yet. So, or at least not affordably, I should say. So, that's where he pressed. And apparently, either Franklin or Colt did not listen carefully because they had just the right man for the job, and they ignored him. This is William Mason, who had begun his firearms career as a pattern maker, eventually employed by Remington Arms, where in 1865 he had received a patent for a swing-out cylinder and star ejector. Mason left Remington in 1866 to work as superintendent of Colt, and was a big part of Colt's transition to centerfire metallic loading cartridges. He had also been, along with Charles Richards, the major designer behind the successful Single Action Army, and chief designer of the 1877 and 1878 double actions. With the 77 and 78 doing poorly in Europe, Mason dusted off his swing-out cylinder patent. And with the help of one Carl J. Evitz, a man we'll talk about later, he would end up with an 1882 prototype. This gun would be sent overseas to Oppen, who would, amazingly, dislike it. You know, the man asks for something, he gets it, and apparently it's not enough. And apparently nobody in this situation other than Mason seemed to understand what they were dealing with, but that's beside the point. So, the Colt factory would sift around for other designs. They started playing with other options, and you can see from the patents that they sort of trend away and away from the original Mason for a while. Well, around the same time, Colt would make another odd mistake, and they would release a lever action by the name of the Colt Burgess. This obviously earned the ire of Winchester, who proceeded to recruit William Mason away from Colt. They would take his 1882 revolver design and work it into something startlingly good, the Winchester 1883. With each company having fired a metaphorical shot, they both decided to settle on a treaty now, before any blood was shed. And so, there were some quiet handshakes, and Colt left the rifle market, and Winchester left the revolver market. But not before having shown their design to the U.S. Navy. And the U.S. Navy really liked it. But they were also really broke. Following the Second American Revolution, the Navy was stripped the bare bones, and even their steamships were ordered to use sail power unless absolutely necessary. With such austerity, naval pistols were barely a consideration. Instead, they'd carry on with the 1851, now updated by a familiar name, to chamber a 38 caliber metallic cartridge. The funding would come only after a number of flare-ups between the US and Spanish forces in South America. There's honestly a number of these incidences and they're worth tracking down, but I'm not gonna go into them. The short answer is that our wooden ships were, you know, clanking up against Chilean steel boats. Like, it's not a good combination. So, in 1881, when President Arthur came to power, he really wanted to push for a stronger American Navy, and he did. By 1886, these funds would trickle on down to the handgun level of procurement. And at that point, one Captain Sickard, it's spelled like Picard with an S. Anyway, he would go ahead and send out a request to five U.S. manufacturers for a double-action 38 caliber revolver as an example of what they could produce. Smith & Wesson would send their new departure top break. Remington was in receivership, so they couldn't compete. Colt sent their 1877 and 1878 revolvers. Winchester honored their deal with Colt and opted out. And Merwin, Hulbert & Company sent a 44 caliber double action to the wrong address. None of these fit the bill for what the Navy had wanted, which was essentially the Mason's Winchester design. So they would reach out directly to Colt and see if they could get close to it. Captain Sickard would request the following: a solid frame, a double action, 38 caliber with a 5 or 6 inch barrel, a 6-shot swing out cylinder, and a grip and trigger guard something akin to the Thunderer. Also in this same letter, there is reference to a previous Colt design with a swing-out cylinder, so it's likely that the U.S. Navy also got a chance to see that 1882. Now, luckily for Colt, Good old Ebbets had not lost the notes from William Mason, and those patents were pretty much done for. So, hey, we can go straight to it. As a matter of fact, Ebbets would go on to improve the design. Born in Germany in 1845, Carl Ebbets' history is in fact a bit Spartan as far as I could find. We do know he was a gunsmith for Colt as far back as the Gatling gun, where he was both a designer and largely handled the Colt patent filings, in which he's often listed as an attorney. This means his name appears alongside others like Mason and Pyrd. We can see in his patent awarded later in 1888 the basic layout of what would become our revolver today. After some back and forth, Colt would, in 1887, send over a copy of their newest prototype design. And the Navy liked it, but there were two big complaints. One, they were very concerned about the durability of the small parts in the gun. They hadn't had anything this complex before, and they really didn't think it would hold up in battle. Now, that problem was dismissed by good old Franklin, who wrote a very lengthy and complicated and fairly honest letter about the hardening process and the strength, and he assured them that everything was going to be fine. And he was right. It is fine. And then number two complaint was that they just didn't really care for the grip. And so Colt did the smartest thing they could do. They made up a bunch of dummies with different style grips and shipped them off the Navy and said, take your pick, guys. Of course, they would settle on basically the same grip as their previous cartridge conversion. So in May of 1888, Captain Sicard happily notified Colt of the approval to purchase 5,000 revolvers at $12 each, and the new Navy double-action self-cocking revolver was born. Sorta. Steel worker strikes stalled the process, and this would become the model of 1889. Deliveries of the first contract would wrap up in December of that same year. It chambered the 38 Colt Navy cartridge, which evolved from the 38 long centerfire conversion cartridges. The most outstanding feature is the healed bullet. As we'll see shortly, this is the immediate predecessor of the classic 38 long Colt. In March of 1889, the Army would request their own example of this revolver, and then they would form a trials board to compare it to the Smith & Wesson New Departure, which we have talked about in the previous episode. Just to recap, 100 of each design were ordered and issued to 9 cavalry troops. 7 of those 9 preferred the Colt, and I prefer Jerry Ryan. As usual in military procurement, this resulted in just about nothing, and the whole process was started over again in November of 1891, now with only 94 of each revolver being left over. I don't even know where the other 6 went. Comparing the two revolvers, the Army decided, well, the Colt had fewer parts, the Colt had a single action option where the Smith & Wesson didn't, the Colt had better balance and comfort, the Colt was more resistant to rust, mostly because of that Smith & Wesson top brake getting gummed up, the Colt had a better trigger, but the Smith & Wesson had a cylinder stop, and that was super important. The second batch of trials was conducted by 13 cavalry officers, and 11 would side with the Colt, 1 with the Smith & Wesson, and 1 said, nuts to both of these, I prefer the single-action Army. What are you, you ain't got time enough to cock the hammer yourself? You're lazy these days, you kids. We don't worry about that guy. Now, there were only 3 problems outstanding with the Colt as far as the Army was concerned. They wanted them to stiffen up that rebound spring. They were also worried about the sort of sharp edges at the rear of the grip. And honestly, the old Navy model is very rough right there on your hand. And then 3, they wanted a gosh darn cylinder stop. There's no reason for this gun, when holstered, to rotate and possibly mess up between live and already fired cartridges. Just throw it in there, guys. And with that, the Colt model of 1892 New Army was born. Tested in March of 1892, it fired 1,000 double-action and 350 single-action shots with no malfunctions, and was approved for purchase at $12 a pop. Man, you get a lot of extras from that $12, Navy. The initial order for 5,000 was delivered through July of 1893, and 3,000 more were ordered before that was even finished. The big changeover was the inclusion of a cylinder stop, which, while not necessary to the overall function of the revolver, helped prevent mistakes like misplacing your fired shots from your unfired when holstering. Plus, it served to better lock the action at the moment of fire. The new Army also introduced a new cartridge, modified from the naval pattern. It used a hollow-based, internally lubricated bullet with grooves set under a slightly lengthened case. It would be sold to the public as 38 Long Colt. Before we get any further into this, I want to say that the markings for Colt New Army and New Navy revolvers are varied and intricate. We are not going to get into them today. That is too much, and if you would like to know more because you own one, then I highly recommend checking our description below for our favorite book on this topic, and basically the only really detailed book I know of on this topic. It is an absolute must-have if you plan on collecting any of these guns. Now, what I will get into, though, is a severe variety of changes to the gun, because some of you may know, these are very confusingly named most of the time you see them, because, yes, we know New Navy and New Army, but then there's like 9 variations of each, it seems like, with all these different model years on the butt. And that comes down to a number of small changes incrementally. And we're going to see this again when we get into the US Krag, although we may not do that for World War I. Don't go crazy, guys. I'm still doing some research on whether or not they actually made it to Europe. Now, what we can start to say is that the first major problem that they found with this gun is that if you had the latch not quite closed, just a little bit out of battery, you may still be able to have the hammer fall on the primer, and that means that you're shaving or splitting a bit of the round off, or you're just not quite lined up with the bore and it's throwing off your accuracy. Neither are great. And so what they needed was a way to make sure that this did not go bang unless you truly had it closed. Now, a man by the name of Felton would wrap this up in 1894 with a tidy little patent. Frank milled a shallow recess in the left side of the frame and set a thin lever in place. The top of this lever rode in the cylinder release catch, so that if it was back, and therefore out of lock, the lower portion of the lever would block the path of the hand pin, which had been extended to fit into that recess that he had made. This locked up the action. Approving the fix, the Army would purchase 3,000 of these model 1894s, which were all delivered by the end of April 1895. At which point, 5,000 more would be ordered, delivered by the end of June 1896. Now, the Navy was 2 updates behind, so they ordered 2,000 more revolvers, plus 382 for naval militia. It became the updated model 1895, with all being delivered by the end of July of that year. I should also note that some 5,000 new Army revolvers would be sold to Argentina, as the Modelo 1895, sporting a lanyard ring, hard rubber grips, and this handsome crest. So at this point, we have both U.S. armed forces up to date as to the most modern version of this revolver. But what about the old ones? They have problems. They can detonate with it slightly out of battery, and they don't have cylinder stops if you're the Navy. Well, for the Army specifically, Colt would quote them a price of $3.50 for the update of the previous model. Well, Springfield Armory's commander scoffed. He wanted to order replacement parts from Colt, and then have his staff complete the repairs. Colt would argue, probably rightfully, that, whoa, you can't just order replacement parts for guns that never had those parts. Like, when we do this, when we structure out our pricing on these things, we include replacement parts as sort of like a guarantee. Like, we're saying this is a good quality product, so we'll price you at this for replacement parts, because we really don't expect you to need them very often, if at all. And then, you know, now Springfield's going, well, hold on, you're making these replacement parts for us for these other guns, so, you know, we have a right to order them for that price. And then Colt's going, hold on, there's a previous model in the works here. On the previous model, we didn't have that patent, and you didn't pay a little bit on that patent amount to kind of, you know, pay us for that work. And then the Army would say, it's $12 either way for either. Anyway, it goes back and forth. And you could see the case for either side, but technically, the Army did not pay for the patent on that part from the first batch. And therefore, technically, contractually, they could not order them as replacement parts. So what they did do is negotiate down to Colt sending in parts and Springfield doing the work. And it came out to the number I've seen is $1.69. Now, I don't know if that's what Springfield paid for the parts to Colt instead of $3.50 for the whole process, or if that's the sum total of the Colt parts negotiated plus Springfield's amount in terms of labor on top of that. I lean towards the latter because I believe the replacement cost was something like $0.10. So there's a lot of margin in there. But either way, Springfield would do the first round of these upgrades. And working back the numbers, it seems, as best we can tell, unless there's a missing sheet somewhere, that only 333 of the previous model escaped upgrade. Springfield did not remark these guns, so the tell is on the left side of the frame. If you have an 1892 marked butt, and there's not the tip of a screw visible here under the release, congratulations. It is very rare and was not upgraded. Now, the Navy would have to make a much broader jump. They had to go from a gun without a cylinder stop in the 1889 to a gun with a cylinder stop and all this safety mechanism in the 1895. So that's more expensive. And the best price I could find for the cost, which they did pay to Colt to do these repairs, or upgrades, I should say, was somewhat less than $7, which seems like really good accounting, guys. But anyway, it's a huge process to rework those guns, so it's understandable that it would be much more than the Army's amount. And there's fewer of them, thankfully. But that doesn't mean that it went by quickly, because realistically, with ships out to sea having to come back and forth to get this done, it was done in small batches until about July of 1900 before it was finally complete. And again, it makes the originals very rare. So if you find, you know, an original Navy without the cylinder stop, good, grab on, hold on. Now, the other thing that's interesting about these is that Colt, since they did the work, also managed to remove the original patent dates and stamp new ones on to get it caught up to all those 1895 protections. Returning to our general history lesson, the U.S. would intervene in the Cuban push for independence from Spain, and on February 15, 1898, the USS Maine, anchored in Havana Harbor, would explode and sink. The Naval Court of Inquiry at that time decided it was caused by an underwater mine, which detonated both the Maine's magazines. Today, it's still a bit of a debate what truly caused the explosion, but it seems Spain was not at fault. Whoops. Regardless, the U.S. became cemented on Cuban independence. Oh, and as an aside, investigating the wreckage of the Maine, one William S. Cowles would find and keep a naval 1895 Colt revolver. Taking it home with him, he would later gift it to his brother-in-law, one Theodore Roosevelt, who would carry it as his personal sidearm into Cuba and that Battle of San Juan Hill. Now, through rising tensions, we would slowly see the U.S. go into April of 1898, and towards the end of the month say, look, Cuba's free, or it's on. And then Spain said, well, fine, we're at war. And then the U.S. said, look, when we said it was on, we meant it was on. We've been at war for 4 days. You don't know. But anyway, there was a war. It would last 10 weeks, and it's an interesting turning point in world power, but it's really too big for us to sort of wrap up tightly today. Instead, we'll go for the boring detail that the Navy would order 235 more 1895 revolvers during this period. And they'd also probably pick up a few commercial ones. These are harder to track. The Army, however, expanded radically, going from 28,000 standing soldiers to 65,000 plus over 200,000 volunteers for that conflict. That meant the Army was drastically short on equipment, including revolvers. They were quickly authorized some $50 million for expansion, and so more contracts were let out. In May, 5,000 more model 1894 new armies were ordered. This would not be fulfilled until August, so many from this batch never even made it into the war. A good number of soldiers fielded by the U.S. were drawn from state National Guards. While they did bring their own mixed equipment, the Army would refit them with the standard Krags and Colts. But then those bastards marched home with them. So thanks to the amended Militia Act, the Army was permitted funds to replace equipment that wandered home to the states post-war. This meant another late 1898 contract for 5,000 more Colt 1894s. Following the war, 11,000 troops would be shipped off to the Philippines to face a growing conflict for independence. This meant more Colt revolvers, with small batches slowly totaling roughly 3,000 by 1900. Also, in late 1898, the U.S. Army would look at their revolvers a little more seriously again and try to decide whether or not this thing was still suitable. Ultimately, they decided, yes, it's fine. However, we want two changes. One, seriously, ramp up the hand pressure. And then two, can we get a lanyard ring? Because Butterfingers over here keeps dropping his. This resulted, confusingly, in the model of 1896. Seriously, I have no idea what went on here. It's very likely the spring was strengthened, although I don't know of anyone checking it, and I don't really have any examples for myself to check. Plus, they all were kind of refurbed after the fact, so it'd be really hard to know if it was the right tension to begin with. Regardless, some 9,500 of these babies were ordered in two contracts from August and December of 1899. Note that Colt did not catch the memo about that lanyard ring. That didn't really matter, though, because just as these things were starting to arrive, well, the US was starting to consider another revolver. Like we said last time, in the Philippines, they were having bad luck with the 38 caliber cartridge because they had men with sheer determination and sharp pointy sticks running them in the gut. And believe me, you can hit a man 6 for 6, and if it doesn't hit something vital, he can still give you a poke before he finally lets go from blood loss. And that proved to be a big problem. So a whole new round of trials would sort of kick off, although not as in-depth as complete replacement. It was more like, hey, what are our options here? And we know from our last episode that that would result in the Smith & Wesson model of 1899 and its superior 38 special cartridge. In February of 1901, they would order 1,000 of those Smith & Wessons, and that made Colt very apprehensive, so they put forward two solutions. One is very important for our next episode, because one of the bigger issues with this gun, just like we had talked about last episode, is the clockwise versus counterclockwise rotation thing. And to solve this, Colt offered up a clockwise rotating mid-frame revolver with some other little improvements. Now, this is going to go on to turn into something completely different, as you will find out next. But what the Army ultimately went with was an upgrade of the current system known as the 1901. Now that amazing upgrade was a lanyard ring. Seriously, they put a lanyard ring on it. Now the model 1901, roughly 19,000, would be ordered and delivered by the beginning of 1904 in several lots. Starting in August of 1901, both Springfield and Colt would begin ad hoc programs to update existing new Army models to the 1901 pattern by adding a lanyard ring. Because of the two separate converters, manufacturing markings can vary wildly. Again, I recommend reading a proper book. Now, in 1902, we'll see another 2,000 naval revolvers ordered, the 1895s, and in 1903, we'll see another 3,000. Those are helpfully similar numbers. Anyway, these would be the last of the new navies. Over on the Army side, well, Colt had to keep them in the game because in 1903 there was another amended militia act. This is going to be another big chance to really get a lot of money on big contract handguns. Now, we know the 38 special cartridge was developed to allow Smith & Wesson to field a revolver that could chamber both 38 long Colt and beat it for power with this optional loading. Now, structurally, the Colts can handle 38 Special, but Smith & Wesson's attention to milling the chamber to fit the bullet and their tighter bore were factors in the power of that new cartridge. Colt could not match the cylinder, but they could tighten their bore to build up some more pressure, and so they did. This resulted in the model 1903, which also has a shortened up butt to improve the grip and bring it closer to that of the Smith & Wesson's profile. Between July of 1903 and June of 1904, the US Army would take in 12,500 of these guys. So with all of that, we are finally, guys, up to our current revolver that I have today, for the most part. That means that we can finally take a closer look at just what went into this little gun. Alright, so this shouldn't be unfamiliar to anybody out there. We have a single, and double, action revolver. We have a swing-out cylinder with a latch that pulls rearward. That's the Colt way, the Smith & Wesson way is the pushies. And then out and simultaneous manual eject. I really can't get into too much detail because if you guys don't understand this part, I can't help you. These things are practically idiot-proof in their current iteration. So, let's just go ahead and take a look inside. Now, again, I think it's best if I speed things up so you don't get too bored. And cheers. Ha! Let's try that again. Ha! Oh, there we go. Now, you want to be careful removing these because there is a pin here. Can you guys see that? That pin is responsible, and let me get some of this out of my way and grab my patented plastic pokey hand. It's responsible for pushing forward on that hand. So let me give her a run real quick so you guys can just see. Single action. Hooray. And let her down. And then we'll go for, you can only see so much, but double action. And without going crazy. There we go. All right, so what's going on in here is the usual arrangement of hand and trigger and two position with the nose and it slips over. We got all that, but the big takeaway is our two springs here. We have our main spring. We have a lower spring that's driving this lever, which then tips our trigger. It helps shape our cylinder stops pattern of behavior there. And then our handspring, like I said, is being powered by a pin in the side plate and its own flat spring. So this guy is really not doing as much duty as we've seen in other revolver designs. All right, ultimately, this is fairly complex, and you really can't even see down into that, out of battery safety. So we'll show you that closer on an animation. We'll load this thing up and take a closer look. Starting with single action, take note of the two flat springs in the grip, one powering the hammer, the other powering the rebound lever. This compound part transfers spring pressure to the trigger via the wraparound arm, and is shaped to rebound the hammer when the trigger is released. We've covered the safety earlier in the show in detail, but here you can see it in action. While we're running the gun in double action, let's keep an eye on those cylinder stops. The most obvious one is a separate lever sticking off the front of the trigger. It's engaged whenever the trigger is released. The second is a projection on the trigger itself, which engages at the rear of the cylinder. All right, let's get this thing over to Mae and see how she does. You know, we seriously considered tracking down a Naval 1895, even though there's no real difference between the performance, and giving that to Mae in addition to this one, along with some round glasses, a great mustache, and some very confusing internal feelings for me. All right, back to the topic at hand. We have talked about where this revolver came from, why it was adopted, and how it served into the Spanish-American War, but there's still a lot of ground to cover. In 1905, we'll see the Marine Corps order their own special version of this Colt. The most outstanding difference is the changeover to a more Smith & Wesson-like rounded grip. Shipped in small lots through April of 1909, these are exceptionally rare with only 812 delivered. Fakes abound, so make sure you do extreme research before buying. Now, the last real consideration of this revolver before we changed over to other types was, well, from 1908 to 1910, about 6,000 more all previous designs together would get updated to that 1903 lanyard ring. And otherwise, it was largely already abandoned, even though it was still in use, because we'd well known by 1905 that the next service cartridge was going to be 45 caliber or greater. We wanted a knockdown power. And as we know, that's going to turn into some very odd designs that really lasted the test of time. But from the Colt camp, we're going to see the 1909 new service first. This big boy revolver is going to be a story for another day, but do not worry, it is going to be in this series. And of course, it would give way to the Colt 1911 as the standard US pistol. Guys, I wanted to just say one thing while we're in the middle of an episode so that it comes through very clearly. The longer I take to make an episode on a specific gun, the more effort we are obviously putting in to get that gun. Sometimes that means they're rare and uncommon, like you'll see with those like Romanian Mannlichers or Serbian rifles or something like that. But when it's something as common as the 1911, just sort of pricey, well, that should lead you to believe that we're trying to go a little bit above and beyond. So patience is key. The sooner I push it out, the less good it's going to be. I mean, go look at the original LaBelle episode. It's fascinating, but it's not perfect. All right, so setting this guy aside, because we're going to do it one better, we have to pick this one right back up because we've wandered all the way into this territory that it's been abandoned, it's been stuck in reserves, it's been washed into storage, and then in 1917 or so for the U.S., war were declared. Now, every time we do one of these non-standard sidearms or rifles or whatever, I like to remind people that World War I was one of attrition, and so you had to bleed the other guy out before you bled out. And production mattered, and reserve weapons mattered. What was dug up was instantly more useful than even the best thing you could make because of the complete lack of resources used to dig it up. With rare exception. So, this gun, yes, is going to turn up in World War I, but first I gotta mention, the US standard sidearm was the 1911, I'm sure all of you know that. Our secondary standard was actually what was known as the Model 1917, which was two distinct and separate revolvers, one by Smith & Wesson and one by Colt, both chambering the 45 ACP cartridge. Even with those two big revolvers and the 1911 in use, there wasn't enough production to really push to match the growing U.S. Army, and so these guys had to come out of storage. In 1917, General Pershing authorized the issue of Colt New Army revolvers to the Signal Corps, engineers, and various other rear echelon troops and guards. The Navy would also reissue their available Colt revolvers to various ships and guards, usually closer to the U.S. than abroad. 45 ACP was still the standard on the front line. The demand for handguns was so great, there was even some consideration of restarting the manufacturing lines for these little guys, but that didn't make a lot of sense because Colt had those resources in a gun that they were using, so I'm not even sure why they looked at that. But they did find an alternative source because a lot of these were stored on the National Guard level. That's where they were still being issued actively. And so the National Guard, well, they were ordered to turn all of theirs in January of 1918 to Springfield. Now, Springfield was overloaded, so they would talk to Colt, and Colt was overloaded, so they both just sort of sat around and went, huh, and these things started to pile up until March when Remington said, you know what, we got it. And then they didn't have it at all, and they sat on them until August of 1918, when they finally would start working on them. And working on them meant taking them apart, making sure it was all still there, and saying good enough, and smacking it with an inspection stamp. I mean, they pulled the trigger, I'm sure, and made think everything was tight, but they didn't add any extra lanyard rings or do any of the upgrades. It was literally just like, this is good enough, and then boom, ready to go. You can spot guns that underwent this inspection by the initials of either Captain Leroy E. Briggs, or possibly one from a small last batch done by Major Edward C. Chapman. In a very rough estimate, it is believed that some 25,000 Colt New Army and New Navy revolvers were used during the war. At least 7,000 of that inspected National Guard batch went to the Navy, so despite being late to the game, they did get issued. While definitely not a frontline revolver and definitely not a second standard revolver, this gun was present for the war. Some of them made it to Europe. They may have even made it into combat with some of those before-mentioned troops if they had certainly found themselves in the wrong place at the wrong time. This is an actual issue gun for World War I. It's just not a very common one. But in the roles it filled at home, it did displace a lot of very usable sidearms. Now, service didn't stop just in World War I. Now, they were declared obsolete. They were drummed out of the army, as it were, after 1918. But a big pile would also get sent over to Britain during World War II as part of that Lend-Lease program. These would be marked out for 38-200 if you can find them today, and they were issued to the Home Guard. All right, so with all that wrapped up and a little bit more appreciation for what went into this little guy, certainly more on the front end than its actual service life, let's go ahead and toss it over to Mae and see how she felt about actually shooting the little darling. All right, we made room once again for Mae and for a fairly long-barreled revolver. Now, we're going to get her opinion on the Colt New Army in terms of World War I, not the Spanish-American War. That's a different story. So let's start, I suppose, with the ergonomics.
Thank you. All right, let's take a moment, guys, and I just want you to appreciate that this is a thing of beauty. I mean, it's really long, sleek, it's slender. It's got some lovely lines to it. I mean, seriously, this is gorgeous. The grip is long and narrow, so I really feel like not only is it long and narrow, so it's easier for me to just get a full finger grip on. I'm very comfortable with it, but it also, the curve in the back, I feel really just falls naturally into the palm of your hand. Everything about this is aesthetically pleasing. It's quite pleasant. I really do appreciate it. I need to take a second to girl out about that. Anyway, the hammer, it definitely sticks out a little bit further than the older Smith & Wesson that we've talked about previous episodes. It's got a nice little spur up here at the top. So I really feel like when I'm trying to cock that hammer back, it's comfortable. Everything about that feels right. Like I feel like I'm really able to get a good purchase on it whenever I'm pulling it back. And then I will say I did prefer this in the Smith & Wesson when I've just got to be able to push it forward in order to release a cylinder. It is a little bit harder to pull back. Not harder necessarily. It's a little more awkward to pull back on this lever back here in order to release the cylinder. That is a little more awkward, but as you can see, still able to do it one-handed. It's still pretty comfortable. Just not my preferred motion, I guess. It just doesn't feel as natural to pull back as it does to push forward. I feel like I have to almost like loosen my grip a little bit to do that. But otherwise, ergonomics-wise, it's very attractive.
Yeah, the new army feels like that sort of missing link between the old and the new. It's gorgeous, it's classic. It is sort of the essence of revolver. Not to the bare minimums, because we've certainly seen some much more minimalistic revolvers in this show. But maybe in the American psyche, it's the minimal American revolver. And again, I agree with Mae. There's something about it that feels slimmer, lighter in terms of dimensions, even though the overall weight, especially with that long barrel, feels kind of heavy to me. Mm-hmm. But that's not where this stops. So we need to talk about actually firing the gun. So how did that go for you?
All right. So I need to start off with first saying these sights are actually the smallest sights that I have shot so far to date for the series. They are very difficult to read, especially when you're realigning your shots every time. I really feel like out of everything so far, this is the like point and shoot. This is definitely that gives me the definition of it right here when handling this firearm. Now handling the hammer, like I mentioned before, it's got a nice little spur up here at the top. It is longer, so I am able to pull it back. And thank God they added that extra little bit of length to it, because not only is that hammer actually heavier than a Smith & Wesson K-frame, for instance, but it's also got a longer pullback. So if anything, that spur really was necessary, in my opinion, in order to make it easier to operate. And then follow up, single action, it's pretty much the same as a Smith & Wesson K-frame, but double action, it's very heavy, I will say that. However, it's much smoother than a Smith & Wesson K-frame. I will say that it is actually like almost like glass. It is very smooth all the way through. I don't really sense when the break is coming in this one, which is actually quite nice. But again, it is still much heavier, so be prepared for that. Last but not least, of course, the recoil. I kind of felt like it was pretty much manageable. I didn't have any problems, I felt. It was like any other revolver, rocks in your hand, bring back down. Of course, the sights, you have to realign, but like I said with this one, it's pretty much a point and shoot, so have fun with that. But again, recoil, totally manageable in my opinion. I didn't feel like at any point I was losing my grip. Shooter-wise, it was fun for shooting, a little difficult to realign the sights, and the heavier hammer and trigger weren't my favorite, but at least they were smooth and easier to operate.
Yeah, this guy weighing in about the same as the K-frame, and with the added bonus of the longer barrel, 38 long Colt's not pushing as hard, so she's a mild shooter. We had a lot of fun with her on the range. Mm-hmm. But what does that mean when it comes to actually using this in war? Are you comfortable on a battlefield with this little six-shot chambered in 38 long Colt?
So this one's actually going to get a soft yes with a little bit of a caveat. Just let me explain. First off, 38 long Colt, it's an okay cartridge. It's middle ground. It's middle of the road, basically. I'd prefer 38 special if I were betting my life on it. But again, okay for the cartridge, not best. The sights were terrible, so not my favorite. However, the trigger, the hammer, while a little heavy, were still perfect. They worked well. I love the lines on it. The grip was great. I still shot well with it, and I handled the recoil just fine. So it had a lot of good going for it, which is why it gets that soft yes. The problem is, 1918, I still had a chance to maybe have some good ones in there. However, by that time, they were still kind of showing some signs of a little bit of wear. It's kind of this counterclockwise rotation. It's working against the gun. So really, time was not on this guy's side. And now it's 100 years later. This one's got some decent cylinder wobble in it. I could see it shaving rounds. I know it probably didn't help with my accuracy on it. So today, I wouldn't bet my life on it. In 1918, if I have one in good condition, again, it would get a yes. But unfortunately, for what I take into battle, just not knowing, it's got to get a soft yes in my book.
I think that's a fairly good assessment. I mean, may I?
Sure.
These things had been in reserve status, National Guard status. You don't know how well they've been cared for. You don't know how many times they've been shot. And because of that unique problem to this gun, that absolutely fatal flaw of clockwise and counterclockwise fighting each other between the crane and the cylinder, you're looking at some wear. And when you get a hold of one of these guys that's been shot over the course of its life quite a few times, you'll notice that that crane does tend to flex. It's a fatal error to this gun on the margin. Overall, at 10 feet, is it going to be a problem by 1918? No. But is it ideal? Do you want it to be the thing that's got your life? That's rough. I think May answered it appropriately. I think it all depends on the condition as to whether or not you're happy with it. Because again, I agree, 38 long Colt is a very decent cartridge. I certainly think it would stop a man, maybe not, you know, a super determined man, but in a European war, sure. I'm going the long way around to say that I agree. It's going to come down to condition. And I'm glad that we have one that isn't really perfect, because it shows that on the outer limits of sort of the acceptable range for these, you can still do some damage. Alright, so I suppose that's going to wrap us up for today on the Colt New Army. So we'll see you guys next week for one last bit of a sort of semi-three-parter on some medium-frame revolvers from World War II, or for World War I, not II, we're not there yet. But join us after the credits for updates. I'm not even going to attempt to tell you anything right now, because we are filming ahead of time, and things are changing so freaking fast, guys. Keep an eye on us on whatever social media you like, because there's going to be a lot shifting in the wind lately.
Later, everyone.
Alright, updates. First things first, thanks everyone who contributed on Patreon after my most recent campaign of whining. Second, I need to make two special thanks because this episode almost didn't happen. Due to a footage error, we had to go out and reshoot our revolver. In addition, we did not have our revolver to reshoot because we had already filmed all these segments and returned it. So I was very lucky that Taylor of CNS Shooting Sports happened to have one that he was willing to loan me. And due to scheduling conflicts, I was very lucky that Dave Triana of Triana Protection was able to lend us some land to film on in very, very short notice. So if you like this episode, please take a moment and visit either of these businesses on Facebook or social media of your choice and say thanks for us. That's it, guys. One more bit of revolver next episode, and then something entirely different.